It's funny talking about sin and forgiveness because most of the time, the people who I think are most suited to do so are the people that you, that most would probably say are at least deserving to speak about it. And I can tell you I'm very suited to speak about sin and forgiveness. So I'll do it anyway. But you know, growing up in a Christian home, forgiveness is something that you're taught from a very young age. But it's when you're little, it's something that you don't quite understand. You get the general idea of what it is, the gist of it, but as far as really grasping the meaning behind it and the need for it, that's just kind of lost on you. I think partially because there's not really a need for it at that age. I mean, you do stupid kiddie things, everybody does, that's part of, you know, learning what is and is not okay. But, I mean, kids have the luxury, this is like one of those, if I knew now what I knew then kind of things, kids have the luxury of being free from the, you know, the perceptiveness and the understanding that comes with age, and so, therefore, from being free from the real need for real reconciliation and forgiveness. And I think, the funny thing is, I think kids think they understand exactly what sin is and what forgiveness is. I remember very clearly being in third grade, and I was at a private school at the time, and one day in class, our teacher was talking to us about something. And I remember sitting there at one point thinking, man, I can't wait until I'm an adult so I don't sin anymore. Which is hysterical, and I wish I was there, 22-year-old me was there to laugh at 9-year-old me. But it's true, I thought at the time that I really understood what sin was, and I thought that I understood what forgiveness meant, and I thought that there would come an age where there wouldn't be any need for either of the two. And I have my notes here, because I figured I'd forget at some point what it is exactly that I was going to say. But it wasn't until I was about 14 that really understanding how something could be really wrong or really broken within myself came about. One of the things that I find frustrating about the internet, which I increasingly see as just a nuisance more than anything else, is that if you're a kid that doesn't know to be careful, anything is going to pop up. Because that's how my current struggle with pornography. Sin is a degenerative thing. It's the kind of thing where if you don't fix it right from the start, if you don't catch it right at the start, it just continues to get worse and worse and worse, and it gets more and more difficult to fix it. And after about a year of that, I still hate saying this. After about a year of that, there came a point where that was pretty much all that I could think of throughout the day. And eventually, I mustered up the courage to talk to my folks. They were very loving about it. They were great about helping me find ways to, you know, kind of cut that struggle off at the source as best I could. And I knew that they forgave me, but I didn't grasp exactly. I didn't know forgiveness. I had my own very elementary understanding of it that I had from when I was little, but I really didn't understand it yet. So fast forward 5 years, I'm going on 20, 5 years later, it's still an on-and-off struggle, but I can't tell my folks that because I told them that once and they already forgave me. It's been 5 years, that would just be pathetic. It was the way I was thinking, that'd be sad, I can't do that. So that year I go, that January, I think it was actually like the first, it was like New Year's Eve through the 5th, I go to the National Seat Conference that year, which is, it's a great conference. It's college students from all over America come to it. But it's a weekend where, you know, I spent praying and listening to talks. And there was one talk in particular that for the first time gave me some actual hope that I really could, you know, stop this thing, that I really could be healed of this struggle. So I go home, I tell my dad that it's still been a struggle over the last several years. And we find a way for him to become my accountability partner, really, of sorts. And it goes well for a while. You know, I get to confession as often as I can about it. And it feels like it's going well. But I still, I don't know forgiveness. understand forgiveness. So it's going well for a little while, like a really little while, and then the hype from the treats kind of dwindles away, and it starts to become a bit of a problem again, even with the help from my dad. So then it's springtime, and I meet this girl, and over the next few months, I'm in a relationship that only in hindsight would I recognize as being very unhealthy, because rather than getting me on a path that was giving me some kind of healing or directing me towards it, it was actually making it worse. And because I'm a moron, or because I was especially stupid at the time, I saw the struggles, and I looked at them as opportunities to practice being better. So if you remember anything that I say tonight, please remember that if you're in a situation like that where you have things that you can see as opportunities to practice being better in a relationship that are that kind of negative, stop. You need to take a step back and stop. But anyway, eventually I see that something is not okay. So I break up with this girl and I go to confession and I talk to the priest who was at the time my spiritual director. And I think that this is going to make me feel better. It just does not. I've gone to confession. I've talked to the priest about it, but I don't understand forgiveness yet. I don't know what it is in its entirety. So fast forward a year. It's October 2016, like a few months ago, and I've spent the last year just stagnant, and I'm confused because I get to confession. I mean, porn is still a struggle, which is not cool, but I get to confession about it as often as I can. I have my dad for help. I talk to my spiritual director, so I'm very uncertain as to why this is still an issue. So it's October 5th. I've just woken up for classes from a night that was particularly difficult, and I get all my stuff together for class, and I drop it, and I sprint to the Neumann Center on campus, and I run inside, and there's nobody in the chapel. So I run inside, and I just get on my knees, and I just start talking. All these words come out. You know, I'm sitting there like, Lord, I've been trying to fix this for years. Really trying to fix this for years. Why is this still a problem? Why am I not healed of this yet? You know, I want to be a husband. I want to be a dad. I want to be just a whole person, and that can't happen if this isn't fixed. So what's the deal? So I'm sitting there, I'm saying all these things, and I get to a point where I'm just in complete brokenness and utter exhaustion. The last thing that I can get out is, I can't do this anymore. I need you to do this. And there was something. There was this peace that had not been there for a while. But more than that, what it was that I could hear somebody saying, yeah, you're on the right track. Keep going with that. You see, that was the first time that I realized that not only can't I do it myself, I'm not meant to. It's not my job to. It's because, oh no. No. That was the first time. I mean, I realized I had sought forgiveness many times before that, many times before that day, but I really only understood it in a very base level fashion. Because it's not about, you know, I'm sorry, great, you're forgiven, go try again. Yeah, I'll go try again. It's about you saying, I'm sorry, and God saying, let me help you. Let me carry you. It was in that particular moment that my current journey, my very early still journey of realizing forgiveness and healing really began. Because it was a long time before I was even willing to ask God for help, because I'd always think to myself, I can't. And And I don't mean like I don't want to or I am afraid to. I can't, as in I don't deserve to. I think that's the tragic thing about sin. That's the worst part of it. More than the acts itself, whatever they are, is the fact that it so wrongly impacts our assumption about the way that God thinks and the way that he feels about us. Or it might be better to say that it gives us an assumption, period, which doesn't need to be there. Because by human standards and by human thinking, I did not deserve forgiveness. I did not. But God doesn't think the way that we think. I think we tend to complicate God a lot of the time. I think we can't help but box him into our own human nature. We give him all of our standards and our expectations and our limitations, even. But thank God, God does not operate under our expectations or our standards. I think we tend to look at forgiveness really as a privilege earned by the perfect, which is so backwards, because it's not the healthy that need a doctor, it's the sick. You know, the perfect don't need forgiveness, so it must be for the broken. And if it's for the broken, it's not an earned privilege, so it's got to be a gift. And if it's a gift, and a gift of that kind by someone to someone who doesn't deserve it can only be given out of love. And how much more a gift of love is it that it's not given to us just once, but every single day, if necessary. More than once a day, if necessary. Because you guys, I'm so weak. This particular struggle, I cave under that so disgustingly easily, and it makes me so sad. It makes me so angry most of the time. I want to be fixed, and I want it to be fixed, and I want to be perfect. But I don't think that forgiveness is meant to build us up to perfection. Not at least as humans define it. Because when we think of perfect, we kind of picture this state of like perfect rightness without the need for help from anything or anybody. But I think that's exactly the opposite of what forgiveness is meant to build us up towards. Because if anything, in my experience, I think forgiveness is meant to humble us into realizing that if we were meant to be perfect, we would be perfect. And that rather than trying to seek some kind of unreachable state where we need to learn to seek God himself, who is perfect, we need to learn to seek him alone and let him do the rest. So I'm going to finish with a song, if I may, by a guy named Rich Mullins, who is just a beautiful human being. But it's based on the prodigal son. And the prodigal son, I think, that's a story that we tend to anymore kind of lose the real weight of it because we hear it so many times as we grow up. But in that time, in that culture, I think it's very similar to the writing of a will for us today. But in that culture, the custom would be that those two sons, they would have received their share of the father's fortune and estate only after he had passed away. And that was something that those customs were things that they would have taken very seriously. So for the prodigal son, for him to go to his father and basically demand his share of his father's fortune and estate, he was practically saying to him, I wish you were dead. I don't need you, I just need what I'm going to get from you eventually anyway, so can I? Is that a gift to him? So he does this terrible thing to his father, but then when he's reached a point where he can't sink any lower and he has no choice but to go back to his father, it says in the story, Jesus says in the story, while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son and he threw his arms around him and he kissed him. for an apology. He didn't wait for some act of contrition. He didn't wait until his son had earned forgiveness. He didn't even wait until he was back at the house. He saw him where he was at, far off, and he took off running to meet him where he was at. And for all he could have known, you know, the son could have been back. He could have been coming back just to ask for more money. But he didn't wait to find that out. He was just happy that his son was making his way home, and he was more than happy to welcome him back. I know it's difficult to trust a lot of the time, but God does not care what we've done. He doesn't care how many times we've done it. He's not asking you to be perfect, and he's not asking that you do it alone. He's just asking that you let him bring you back home.
Thank you.